radio. See, I mean, at the end of the day, it should be very hard to not be sympathetic to a situation like this, because the mistake that happens and what we can get caught up in potentially is that it's so much of this going on that it almost makes us numb to it. But here I am, I'm a guy, I'm that guy who couldn't name one Nipsey Hussle song. That's me.
That's me.
But for some reason, man, when I got the word that he had been killed, it affected me like really for real. I like stopped for a minute and was like man, like I really knew him. I was really like feeling some kind of way because, and I don't know why.
Did you follow his movement?
And I knew, man, I knew from the outskirts what the brother stood for, but I was not immersed into it to where I could just go in detail. But despite that, that affected me some kind of way. And it's been people that have died that I knew a lot of their history, and it didn't hit me like it hit me, you know, when Nipsey died. And that was weird to me.
You know what's crazy about the Nip situation? And I'm one of the people, man, like, you know, I met Nip a couple times. I gave him beats and music. You know what I'm saying? I opened up for him when he came to Houston at Warehouse Live. I interviewed him before that at SF2. So, you know, we had, I don't even say I knew Nip, but, you know,
we had some interactions a couple times,
you feel me? And also, I was watching his whole movement from, you know, back in 2008 when he first started dropping his first stuff or whatever. And then just to watch the progression, man, it was like, wow. He came up and he stayed true to his grind, and he was really independent the full time. You know what I mean? And one thing that I respected about Nip is not only was, you know, he certified and a real street dude, but he also knew that, look, I can't stay this way. I got to transition out of it. And by me being so prolific, you know what I mean? And that's why he had a tattoo on his face. For him being such a polarizer, prolific person, he knew that I got to do something with my influence, because there's so many rappers out here that got this influence and don't do nothing with it, man. And it was just cool. Like, I'm not from South Central or nothing like that, you know what I mean? But it's just cool to know that there was somebody that was out there that was young, that was one of us, that wasn't a microwaved label slave, that was really putting in work and showing young brothers how to do it, man. And for him to die in the way that he died, especially in 2019, man, it's like, okay, so when Pac died, you know, that hurt. That hurt a lot of people. I'm 32 years old. I really wasn't quite young enough to really appreciate the magnitude of Pac passing. With Nip, it's like,
you was right there.
Like I'm old enough now to realize, like, bro, that was really rare what he had.
And see, and that's the difference. It's always somebody. God produces somebody for every generation.
Ain't that the truth?
And it's like from a scriptural point of view, God always sends a prophet and a messenger and a warner to every nation. And even as great as Pac was, and as impactful as he was and still is, it has to be somebody to come behind him, because this world has created a scenario that they will kill off the leaders, and then they will exalt them after they kill them. They did it with Malcolm. They did it with they don't want you around in a physical form, because, like Minister Farrakhan said, a dead leader can't put demands on the people.
A dead rapper is worth more to the label than a live rapper. And that's the sad truth about it.
Without a doubt.
And I ain't gonna lie. Because I was studying Nip's move so long, being an independent artist, when he got with, Atlantic? Not to say nothing bad about them. But once he got with Atlantic, I ain't gonna lie, I got a little bit nervous, because anytime you start colliding with these big wig companies, man, after having such a well-oiled machine that was fully independent, it's like, I don't know.